came out of the archive and they didn't count that. Did I end up something here? Well, I hope you've had a good breakfast. And I know you've been having some give and take. Don and others, and I want to see if you solved all the problems for the year. That's what I really came in for. At our breakfast on Wednesday, as you know, I mentioned that one of my highest priorities this year is to maintain a Republican majority in the Senate. And I know that most of you will face re-election this year, and we want to be supportive in any way that we can. Shortly, I'll send to Congress a fiscal year 87 budget, and it'll meet the requirements of Graham, Brunton, and Hollings without raising taxes or threatening our national defense. I'm also hopeful that the Senate will act expeditiously on tax reform, and I'm counting on you to make some changes in the House-passed bill so that I can sign this important measure, because when I called on the House to get it out of there and keep it going, I told them I was asking them to vote for something that I would veto if it reached my desk in that form. So you've got some changes that have to be made. I imagine you've already covered some of these topics this morning, so I'd rather hear what's on your mind, unless somebody has already noted it or said anything about it. Happy birthday, Paula.
President, we thank you for your hospitality. We look forward to a successful 1986 as you led us in 1980. I have one suggestion to make as we look to the individual campaigns, and that is where it might be possible for you to identify individual senators who are up for re-election on some accomplishment that is consistent with what you think ought to be done. I thought it was very effective when you picked out Senator Mattingly. You made a bad choice, but as a generalization, when you cited him on the line item veto in one of your State of the Union speeches, it was very effective. Now, I don't know in my case you can find anything to talk about. With my colleagues, I know that all of them have done something which would be specific, and we can feed them to Mitch Daniels, and if it comes up in the course of one of your press conferences or speeches where there is that kind of a national focus, it gives quite a lift to an individual senator, and we are not oblivious that we may extract it and use it, perhaps even be so crass as to use it in a commercial. And that could be a centerpiece and enormously helpful, and I think in many cases it could have fit in with some things that we've tried to help you with and that you would endorse.
I think it's a good idea, and feed them in here. We'll see about using them. Let's hope that all of them will be as sensible and brilliant as it was meant to be.
President, I might add to the benefit of the senators, because something that's quite obvious. The more that they support a piece of your legislation, the more they will find interesting quotes.
It's just like a finger on the button of my adrenaline.
Mr. President, you're going to hear a lot about economics this morning, and I just wanted to switch for a minute to foreign policy. As chairman of the Foreign Operations Subcommittee of the Appropriations Committee, one of our jobs, and looking around the freshman class, I don't think there's any group of senators that have been more supportive of your Central American program, the money for El Salvador, the necessary things for Honduras. We discovered Pete Domenici, who was a member of your Central American, the committee there, and a bunch of us discovered the other day that in the working papers in the State Department, they are reading Graham Rudman to reduce Central American funding by roughly 20, in certain cases more than 20%, and taking development assistance money and other money and putting it to other parts of the world, which a number of us think, and I believe you would think, have a much lower priority. In other words, rather than taking the same percentage cut across the world, they have cut Central America at a much greater amount. Now, the hardest money for us to get is the Central American money. And I would hope that Don and all of you, that no one's here from state, but you know, we've got ourselves out there on a limb for trying to promote the program of of peace and democracy in Central America. And right now, in the working papers at the State Department, they are taking a disproportionate cut out of Central America and spreading the money all the way around to these countries, including one of my least favorite, Mozambique, which gets a much less cut than some of these people that have been our friends. So I just wanted to bring that to your attention. And secondly, I'd like to say that I think most of us feel that we're on a very positive role right now in terms of aid to resistance fighters across this world. And I'm pleased with what seems to be now a little bit of a shift in a policy toward Angola. But once more, I think all of us in this room, freshman Republicans, Sweet 16, would identify with you when we start talking about Afghanistan, Angola, Nicaragua. The freedom fighter movements across this country, right, this world right now, are on our side. And all of them ought to be supported. And I'm just pleased. I hope that trend continues. But if you can, I would hope somebody would take a look at taking money out of Central America. It's the toughest money for any of us to get. And then to throw it out, I think, is counterproductive.
Well, I saw Don making notes over there. We look at it because I agree. We cannot allow a communist satellite to be established here on the mainland. And the evidence is irrefutable. Now, about Nicaragua particularly, as a matter of fact, we state positively that Nicaragua is still funneling arms and ammunition and so forth to the guerrillas in El Salvador.
Mr. President, I'd like to just return to politics for a moment and the State of the Union message. Following up on what Arlen said, obviously it's not possible for you to have a State of the Union message that mentions each of the 18 who are running for re-election. One thing you could do, it would be if you had the time in your schedule, sometime there to in advance of the State of the Union, to tape for 4 or 5 minutes with any interested one of these critters, a special message that the Republican Conference could then beam out as part of the coverage of the State of the Union message that night. You know, after you speak, we all go out and elbow our way through the cattle show in the rotunda, and what appeared to be a more or less contemporaneous film clip with you, which allegedly could have been taken that little holding room that you always go into before you give that State of the Union message, promoting whatever it is any of these people have done, if they've done anything, in the 5 years they've been here, would really be a big boost to them. It would be something we never tried before. It would take some time out of your schedule, which I know is tight, but it could be an enormous boost and would solve the problem of how do you give Jim Abner credit for revealing contemporaneous record keeping without necessarily loading up your speech with what might be perceived as a whole bunch of blatantly partisan Republican references. A thought for the day.
A holding room that you mentioned is Tip O'Neill's office.
I want to present it by name to you, Mr. President. A little plaque was made by about an 85-year-old senior citizen who can barely speak. But as you can see, he can write. He made it for you and for the White House. It says, "Bless this house." He signed it on the back, and I have a little letter explaining this gentleman, Mr. Marx, M-A, not related to Carl, M-A-R-Y-C-H, and it says, "Bless this house," and if you could hang it someplace around the White House, except he'd be delighted. If not, I'll take it back.
I'll write it.
Mr. President, I think that we're all gratified to see the economy going. That's certainly one of the enduring strengths of your presidency. But the thing that I feel that you've done the most for this country is in the area of national security and restoring the respect and credibility of our nation. And along those lines, one of the things that you've changed on an attitudinal basis, and I can see it because of Madison Avenue advertising people, you have induced a great deal of skepticism and questioning of the Soviet Union along the areas of trust, and I think it's proper, and I think it's good for our nation. But one of the things that is going to be a problem, and it's a difficult thing when I sit down in my home state of Indiana and start talking about defense matters, is the area where we have said and documented time and time again Soviet violations of the treaties. That they are, in fact, have been, will, and continue to cheat. But where is our response? we have not yet responded specifically to those violations. And someday, I'm afraid that we're going to run out of our credibility on telling the American people, rightfully so, that the Soviet Union have violated these things, are not to be trusted. If we do not take some responses and talk about these responses, I think that we lose a little bit of a risk of going downhill in our, in what you have done, and you have turned this around more than anybody else. So I just indulge you to look at some of these responses that have been suggested to you, specifically responses to the Soviet violations, so we can sustain that credibility with the American people that I think in due time, if we don't, we may lose.
Well, they've been guilty of violating treaties all the way back to the Big Four treaties and so forth, with the agreements at the end of the war. And we have been talking about right now, I must say that since the summit, and this doesn't mean that we are changing our mind in any way about them and their doctrinaire expansionism and so forth, but the one thing that I did lay down in our private meeting with Gorbachev was this distrust between both sides, and they do distrust us. They probably think it's a lot, but it's moral for them to cheat because we're such bums. But the thing that I launched, and I think we've got to give it a try, is, and I launched it, yes, okay, so there's mistrust on both sides between us. I told you that there's only one way we're going to resolve this, and it's going to be by words. We're going to have some deeds, and we're necessarily going to provide deeds to prove our intentions, that our intentions are not hostile, and so forth, and that it's that. Or you might as well face it that they're going to have to put up with an arms race with us for the rest of time, because we will never allow them to achieve a great dangerous superiority over us. So judge us now a little on not wanting to apparently take a trip to Geneva and then just...
I just think we have to at some time address specifically their violations as they continue. We have to do that as an issue.
Mr. President, I want to compliment you. When you came to Oklahoma, you did give me credit for natural gas and leading the effort to deregulate natural gas. I hope that in your State of the Union address, you don't need to mention my name, but I hope that that'll be part of your push, is for deregulation. And I've already talked to Secretary Harrington as late as yesterday, and he mentioned that he would be working towards that. That could help this Senate. If we can pass a natural gas deregulation bill this year, it can help this senator more than anything else I can think of, and I hope that we'll be successful. But in talking about the state and our state in Oklahoma, our economy is very bad, very, very bad right now, primarily because of energy and also because of agriculture. Deregulation of natural gas could help. One comment, and we talked about it briefly Wednesday, somebody mentioned oil import fee, and you mentioned your objection to additional taxes. You're probably right on economics and so on. I would mention this, though. You campaigned in 1980, as this senator did, for repeal of windfall profits tax. And we haven't done that, and for a lot of reasons. Right now, it not so much for just protectionism or just to raise money, but we could have, as a bare minimum, I think, an import tax to equal our domestic production tax, that windfall profits tax. Because right now, we penalize domestic production and encourage imports. There's a heavy tax on domestic production. There's no tax on imports. And so I don't even see that as protectionism. I see that as more just kind of a level playing field, and it would raise a couple of bucks. But it right now, we are encouraging imports and we penalize domestic production because we still have windfall profits tax. And it's not a good tax. And so, one, I hope that you'll make in your State of the Union address a call for total deregulation of natural gas. And two, again, on this issue of oil import fees and so on, in the House passed bill, and you were very helpful to us. The Treasury, too, was much, much better. The House passed bill is a disaster, and if it comes to the floor of the Senate, I'll filibuster. You won't get a tax bill if we're not able to make improvements. I'm confident the Senate Finance Committee will improve it, but when you're looking for some revenues, even without getting into this protection syndrome, I think you could have an import fee to at least equal windfall profits tax without violating any real sound economic trade principles.
Well, we're going to be looking at everything and all of these things, except that we feel right now we've got to keep the emphasis on cutting spending.
I agree.
And we're going to get there and get the job done. But nothing will be left out. And also, I believe that with regard to tax reform, that must stand Simon Pure as revenue equal, but we're not using that as an excuse for getting more money. The other, anything else has got to be treated on the outside of that. But incidentally, if you haven't been told, the State of the Union address is going to be quite a bit shorter this year, and it's going to be more of a general theme, but then the next day you will all be delivered a catalog of all the specifics. We found that trying to put all the specifics in the speech, by the end of the speech, we haven't got anybody tuned in out there. Well, that is,
Mr. President, I first of all want to thank you for signing the farm bill. I appreciate that very much. I wanted to state a fact that even with a much better farm bill than we anticipated maybe a year ago we would get, I don't know whether things are going to be really very much better in 86 and 87, and I don't know there's much in Washington we can do about it, right? Might not be very good for the next 5 years. And for sure, until interest rates come down and the value of the dollar come down, it won't be very good. Now, you'll hear a lot of us from the Midwest talk about agriculture this spring, even in light of what you're saying, a very good bill. And the only thing I guess I would ask in regard to some of the things you might hear from the Hill is that from the USDA and from the White House, we would just get a feeling that things were being considered. That doesn't mean that every idea is thrown out. You got to say it's a great idea, but just not outright rejection of some, so that we at least can get the point of view to the farmers in the Midwest that the White House and the U.S. Department of Agriculture is sensitive to the extreme problems that we have out there. And a lot of the things that are going on, like what the Farm Credit System is going to do, that's not a government agency anymore. They're going to be foreclosing on a lot of farmers. And so there's going to be extreme upheaval out there in the way of a high percentage of farmers going out of business. And we'll be speaking about that. And we, maybe even making proposals. And maybe there are proposals that you can't accept. But if you can just let us have your ear and that you'll consider them, that's all that we would ask. And then I think that in turn would show that we've got Republican senators and a USDA and a White House that's at least sensitive to the problems, even if maybe you can't do anything about it.
Chuck, I think there's been a great false image created of us. I don't know of any specific item on the bill that we've spent more hours on than we have on that. We do know that the situation is one that's very unequal. Some of you come from areas where it is truly a great problem. If you take the whole overall farm economy, it's really only a small percentage that are affected, but that small percentage happens to all live in the same place. It's pockets of sure. That. But we are sensitive to it. We do want to do something, and we will listen to everything that's suggested.
Mr. President, just before you came into the room, there was a discussion about whether or not, from a political standpoint, the summit might best be scheduled in June or in September. I'd like to comment for you and for the people who work for you, my view on that subject, and I suspect every other subject that's been discussed in here this morning. I think that good policy is the best politics. And as Jim Miller told us, the best predictor for success for us is if we are still have a prosperous economy and if people have an affirmative attitude. I think that they will. But the summit, it seems to me, should be scheduled on that basis as well. If the summit is perceived as being successful, it won't really matter whether it's in June or September. And you have spent 5 years subject to a great deal of criticism on your attitude toward nuclear disarmament, including some criticism from some people in this room, and you've been right, and the critics have been wrong, and it has been the fact that you have made America strong, which has given you an immense opportunity today, in the last 3 years of your presidency, really to go down perhaps as the greatest of all peace presidents. And if I could urge you to do anything, usually, as you know, I speak on different subjects when I have an opportunity. I should just like to say that you really do, in one sense, have the Soviet Union in the corner. You've got a different set of ideas. Obviously, they're not totally or completely acceptable yet, but you've got them operating in a far different way than they were before, or that they would have been had we been engaged in unilateral disarmament over the last 3 or 4 years. And I should just like to urge you, following up the answer that you made to Dan Quayle, to make every possible effort that you can to see to it that we do make progress toward the point where we can be working down rather than working up on these nuclear arms. And there is any gift that you can give the people here or the American people themselves that will be more valuable than that if you can make the next summit a success by what you've done in the past.
Well, I haven't retreated from what I said in 1980 in the campaign, that anytime we meet with regard to armaments, and that had been, we've tried to meet with them, I think it's 19 times since World War II. And they have always been the foot draggers. This is the first time that I can recall that they have ever come forth, that the Soviets have ever talked of actually reducing the numbers of weapons. My position in 80 and it still remains the same. There's no more of those agreements where you agree to limit the increase or stay even or anything. Start legitimately reducing the number of weapons. And I said it before, he did eventually get rid of all the nuclear weapons in the world.
You did.
One of the reasons for our timing on wanting it earlier is, first of all, getting up to September is going to be, I have a hunch that I'll probably be doing the campaigning. But also, they're pretty sophisticated about us and our problems. And we think that the closer you get to the election, the more they then might push for concessions that they would think I might have to give to them in order to affect the atmosphere in the election for our side. So we think that if we can get it in June, we're a lot better off. We can devote our time to that, and then there, I think it would be continue to be a good feeling if we could make some accomplishments in June. Now, it may have to be altered some, but we don't want them to get too close to our election, because we don't want them trying to play their politics with our election.
I would just like to say, Mr. President, that the Southern governors are really having a wonderful time holding hearings along the border throughout Texas and in Florida regarding the war on drugs, and lamenting in concert with the House of Representatives. And they have access to the Foreign Affairs, whatever committee you want, that they can pull the leaders down and have a joint hearing. All the governors are the witnesses, stating that you've lost your desire, you've lost the attention span is now gone from that war on drugs, and the increased crossings of the border in Mexico bringing opium in, heroin in instead of marijuana is alarming, and in Florida, of course, cocaine is at an increasing level. If you could just restate our position as a very heavy plank in your continued interest in winning the war on drugs, it may put a lot of these headlines to sleep for a while.
Well, thank you, Paul. All right. I know we have to say things over and over again, because we didn't know we could have the nomination to win this battle.
President Biden, returning to what Chuck Grassley was talking about, agriculture is everything, and state like mining, both Chuck's do, but even more so. That's all we have out there. And we said we're going to improve the economy this year. That's great, but improving the economy doesn't do a great deal all in South Dakota, I can tell you right now. I mean, say what you want to, it doesn't put any more people to work, and it doesn't create any more dollars. We know we're having great troubles, and I know that budget includes a sizable sum for agriculture, but it's still going to be tough. And next Wednesday, the State of the Union message is absolutely imperative. We touch on agriculture, and we show the concern for agriculture. In my case, a young man will be running against me, the congressman in the House, has been chosen to comment on the wrap-up of the Democrats after his speech. on the subject of agriculture, and I can already hear that you fail to at least mention the subject and talk about it. It is a very, very serious thing, and I can't see that it's going to get any better when they tell me, at least this year, before the election. But still, I was one of those that voted for this package most of the day, or my state or whatever members didn't in my state, and I'm still trying to prove it was the right thing to do, especially if you can't be for grand revenue and be for everything in agriculture to go there. I just want to say I helped carry the ball down in Arizona two weeks ago. Had a couple Democrats with me at the hearing. They called the media. And it was good, except in exchange with Van Rob, the commissioner, both of my colleagues there had papers with an exchange back and forth between OMB and Customs that I didn't know anything about. I don't think Van Rob knew anything about. Undoubtedly, you got some career people, someone in Customs or whatever, let things out. And there's doing some very, very severe cuts in Customs. We just put these P3s up in the air and it looks like they may not even be flying. Now let me tell you, if that happens, we haven't got enough money to keep airplanes in the air. We're in the fight drugs and probe what they'll do. These P3s are put to the kind of radar for the first time. We're making a dent on this interdiction. I mean, right now, because we put our strength, we move it somewhere else. But that's extremely important. And the last thing I want to mention, we're going to cut programs, and we have to. Programs back to the state. I have kind of obnoxious guy back there I have to deal with on the programs. But the one thing I think we ought to do is keep the restrictions and requirements where they put up their matching money, keep it less as small as we can as a part of the state, having to meet all the different standards and tests that we put to them. I know you've come out for block grants, you've had the problems on the Hill, but maybe now you can get somewhere talking that way when there are less dollars that I'm sure that all the members of Congress are going to be hearing from their state governments. And sometimes it made it awfully tough for the states to match the dollars we send back. So I just mentioned that.
Well, I appreciate it. I have to tell you from my own experience as governor, there are many federal sharing programs and so forth. There were more before we got some good on that. That as governor, I could put my finger on program after program where if we had been free of the hundreds and hundreds of pages of minute regulations imposed on us by the federal government, we could have done the job better and saved a lot of money. But I just wanted to tell you that yesterday I addressed the National Republican Committee here in the East Room, spoke to them, they and their associates in there, and on the way out, very attractive young lady stepped up and grabbed my hand. I thought she was going to say something nice about me. She told me she was a fan of hers.
this will have to be the last question, Mr. President. Thank you, Mr. President, for having us down. I happen to be one of the ones that favor putting all those sacred cows in government under the tent of the grand revenue. I don't suppose that's going to happen, but I think it'd make cap shop a lot easier if we had the whole budget in there from a defense standpoint. But there's one area I would like to just mention. President Eisenhower was the president who started the Federal Highway Program, and you're the president who built a fire under it. And I think that you gained enormous support, and politically, Republicans have gained a lot more support from the highway lobby, which reaches across all party lines, and I think a lot of us in this room even realize. I'm very conscious of it because of the Transportation Subcommittee. But if we're not careful, we have set aside the sacred cow of Social Security, but the highway program is going to get massacred in Graham Rudman. And I am going to have to be in a position to take it out also, unless the rest of you are willing to put everything else back in the grand revenue. So you could end up, for all of you that voted for the highway bill, which I did, so we raised the tax 5 cents a gallon on the drivers, and then we only give them back 2 cents a gallon, and we use that 3 cents to help balance the federal budget. And I think that, Jim, I submitted some questions in writing to you on that yesterday, but
I think there's a political downside to this, and I would just want to alert all of you to that, that that's very important. People are very sensitive about the funds they get back to their states from the highway because they're all paying for it. And I hope you'll look at that. And one last thing, in the West, where we have these massive acreages of the feudal system of the government owning all this land out there, I hope when you appoint your new Secretary of Agriculture, and I think we've got two outstanding candidates, and Dick Lane and John Norton, and I keep hearing rumors that they're going to pop, and I can certainly, as one person, be happy with either one. I hope you'll emphasize that the Secretary of Agriculture needs to concentrate on what's happening in the U.S. Forest Service, because the Forest Service is getting filled up with environmentalists, and they don't sell trees anymore. We've been beat over the head with Canadian timber, and we can't get forest plans out through that bureaucracy that provides any raw product for our free enterprise sawmills out in the West. If we could get the timber available, we could compete with the Canadians, but we're not making much headway, and I hope you'll get that settled first when you get your new Secretary of Agriculture. But that person is directed to spend some time on leading the Forest Service to sell timber.
And of the danger of bridges, and that one day we could have a great tragedy of collapse maybe with a school bus on it or something, and that it was to be used specifically for transportation. We had to compromise a little with regard to the mass transit people on that, but basically the tax was for that. And I agree, I don't think that we should be trying to balance the budget on that.
Mr. President, on behalf of all of these fine public servants, I want to say one thing in conclusion. In 1985, a year ago, in January, this was a very able, politically strong group. But as we are here in January 1986, we have a much stronger group of incumbents than even we had 1 year ago. They worked hard, but you, Mr. President, and your staff, and Mitch Daniels, and Don, have also worked hard. You have gone literally to the corners of the United States campaigning for virtually all who have asked and who need you, and I know you're going to do more. We would be, however, very poor guests at your breakfast this morning. We did thank you, not just for your hospitality this morning, but for all your efforts and your staff efforts on our behalf. And we thank you very much for the wonderful job, most of all, that you're doing for this country.
Here,
thank you. I thank you. May I just say one thing that I feel very strongly about your assessment? We improve our chances greatly if we are seen as being united and working together rather than giving some of the press people a chance to talk about feuds and fights and so forth because then we look to the people out there as if we're capable of governing. Since they've had 50 years of the other side, I think that would be a big plus. So thank you all for coming out. Let's stay in touch. And even if we have to disagree sometimes, something has to be right. I've got to say that.